Hey everyone, welcome to Business Insider's special virtual event, the MSME Exchange. It's been about a year and a half since the pandemic brought our life to a standstill. Since then, stock markets are testing new highs, corporate profits are piling up. White-collar workers like myself are working from the comfort of their home. Things are okay, all right, I must say. But that's not the story for everyone. Millions of India's micro, small and medium-sized businesses are still struggling. They had barely recovered from the first wave of the pandemic when the second wave came, and it's back to square one. They're really struggling to just survive and be in the race. And any recovery for the Indian economy would be incomplete if it does not take into account and take along with itself all these millions of small businesses and entrepreneurs. They are the heart of corporate India, the heart of India Inc. That's what we are calling them. And this show, over the next couple of days, is dedicated to them. Yes, you will see a lot of marquee speakers, ministers, big corporate leaders, thought leaders who will come onto this platform and share their insights and their ideas on how to improve their lot. A lot of steps have been taken both at the level of the central government and at the level of the state governments. Cheaper capital, lower interest rates, emergency loans, preference in government contracts. A lot of stuff is being done or intended to be done. How much of it is actually trickling down to the ground? How much of it is causing some real change in the lives of these small business owners? That's the question that we are trying to answer here over the next couple of days. And like I said, yes, there will be a lot of big folks here talking to us about what they know and what they think can be done. But that's not the end of it. Business Insider knows, understands that the heart of India Inc. are these small business owners, and therefore the spotlight will also be on those guys. We will bring you some really interesting stories of small business owners, their struggles, their successes, their failures, and everything that they have done to create some change on the ground. Some fascinating stories coming your way along with these big folks who would be sharing the stage with me over the next couple of days. So stay tuned in for those stories as well, and let them touch your heart as well. So on that note, it is time for me to bring in our inaugural guest for the MSME Exchange. So join me in welcoming Palanivel Thyagarajan, the Finance Minister of Tamil Nadu, popularly known as PTR. He was famous when he became a former banker turned politician, became the finance minister of Tamil Nadu, and then he went on to become famous for being famous. He's been making the headlines constantly over the last few days and few weeks, in fact, and some of them controversial, some of them not. But the focus of our conversation is going to be not those controversies, not the drama. Instead, we are going to ask him more about the policies that he has unveiled and more that he's going to do in the days and weeks and months to come. So join me in welcoming PTR to Business Insider's The MSME Exchange, a man who's also famous for being articulate. Unlike, it's a very rare rare quality amongst Indian politicians. And he's articulate not just in English as well as in Tamil. It's a pleasure listening to him, and that's why we have him here for the inaugural session. Thank you, Minister, for taking time out and supporting this cause. Thank you for joining us here on Business Insider's MSME Exchange.
First time, thank you for having me. Thank you for that kind introduction. And let me just clarify that, it's neither my intent nor my role to be stirring controversy. I say what's on my mind. If some people don't like it, that's not my problem. I don't think I've exceeded the bounds of either kind of logic or rationality or even decency in any of the things I've said. So, that's other people's issues. I have no intent in being known for anything other than the job that I do.
No, that's okay. I mean, it's I think part and parcel of your new avatar now. I think you will get used to it as well. And it's always good for us. We get the headlines, I guess. But thankfully at Business Insider, we don't need those. We have a lot of important stuff to talk about, and that's what we're going to do. So, Mr. Thyagarajan, let me then start with the first question, which is the most fundamental problem with India's policy approach towards MSMEs. What do you think that is, both at the central and at the state level? Why do small businesses struggle? And I say this because you can wake up any time of the day, decade, year, and say that there is an MSME crisis, and it would probably be true. So how do we sort of, what is this vicious cycle that our MSMEs seem to be stuck in?
Yeah, it's hard for me to say at the India level because I lived overseas for almost 30 years, and I've only really lived a bit longer than 5 years back in India, and that's all been in Tamil Nadu. But let me just say from Tamil Nadu's perspective and maybe try to extrapolate a bit from there. In fact, the bulk of job creation, as you point out, is from the MSME sector. And that includes the semi-formal jobs as well as all the informal jobs. The previous government, in their own annual kind of demand for grants for the industries department, the statistics they put out have been pretty consistent. I have no reason to believe they were lying. So if that is the case, they show that the average MSME unit in Tamil Nadu employs about 10 people and has about 15 to 20 lakhs of capital. So that equates to a job created for every 1.5 to 2 lakhs of capital investment. If you look at the statistics that the government itself put out for the Global Investor Meet, it shows something equivalent of 28 to 30 lakhs per job created. Now, I understand those are higher level, organized sector, employee benefits and pensions and health insurance jobs, and that they have knock-on effects because they lead to OEMs and all that. But still, a ratio of almost 20 to 1 is an excessive kind of imbalance, in my opinion. And that doesn't take into consideration all the concessions that the government gives for these large enterprises. So I would say the first problem we have, at least as far as Tamil Nadu is concerned, is that the kind of attention and support that we provide to the large businesses, to the global businesses, to the global corporates, to those who come with high profile into the state, we don't provide that kind of support to the MSME sector. So I think that is the first problem. The second problem is we don't have enough tailored or customized support programs for the women entrepreneurs. The third problem is that because of the nature of government and democracy and decay, the rent seeking and the multiple kind of levels of problems, the combination of overly bureaucratic design in what approvals are required, what papers need to be filed, especially after GST, the kind of computer systems you have to have, the integration you have to have, and the rent-seeking behavior or lack of integrity of government servants leads you to this vicious cycle where it becomes very difficult to be a successful small entrepreneur, small scale or medium scale entrepreneur without having friends in high places or some way of beating the system. You put all of that together, and I would say some of it is just structural in the nature of how India works. Some of it is unique to the circle that we live in, the time cycle, the cycle of the economy that we are now living in. I will definitely say that some of it is a clear tilt by the Union government under this ruling dispensation since 2014, where they talk a lot about MSMEs.
I'm going to come to that.
Let me just finish on this. I would say that I have some other observations about banking and capital and all that. But
We'll come to that exactly. So these are, we need to address it at an individual level, but I want to sort of get your sense on the level of pain, in particularly in Tamil Nadu, because you have just come out of an election campaign, you have met people, you have spoken to them, and Tamil Nadu has, like I mentioned in my introduction, lots of clusters, and it's not a one race horse, right? From textiles in Tirupur to chemicals in Kadalur to auto components in Tiruvallur to crackers in Sivagasi. I mean, I can keep going on and on about it, plastics elsewhere. So much is happening, and I'm sure each one of them is facing a different level of pain, a different nature of pain. So let's first understand the problem and the depth of it, and then sort of go ahead with talking about the individual solutions.
Yeah, I mean, I think access to capital, access to resolution of problems when they arise, a lot of interference or a lot of rent seeking in the part of regulatory authorities. Difficulty dealing with the technical complexity of, let's say, staying compliant with GST. The penal nature of the consequences of not being compliant, or the aggressively penal nature.
And then the pandemic, I guess.
Yeah, and of course, I'm just saying this is generic. And of course, you can amplify every one of those statements by the fact in the pandemic.
True.
So but I'd say one other thing, for example, that the design of policy, while some of it may be well intended, almost always gets perverted into kind of either gatekeeper behavior or rent-seeking behavior or both. So even something as simple as a food safety inspector becomes kind of the biggest bane in the lives of, grocery merchants and wholesalers in dal and rice and wheat and whatnot. So I would say those are the kinds of problems that I have received voluminous, GST alone, I probably received 100 pages of complaints. So, there are many MSME support organizations. Some are by product, some are by community, some are by region. And I've spoken to many of them, both during my 5 years as an opposition MLA and also during the campaign.
So in that breath, let's talk about the Atmanirbhar Bharat program, which spent a lot of pages and time talking about how to improve this MSME lot. And then we did see a lot of, you're talking about GST compliance, etc. I know you have asked for a cut on a lot of essential items as well, like basically take it to zero is your recommendation for the period of the pandemic until we recover. I think it's a fair ask. Some may say it's debatable one way or another. I think there is room for a decent conversation to have on this. But let's talk about, because this event is dedicated to MSMEs, let's talk about the Atmanirbhar program's focus on MSME. The MSME fund of funds, the emergency credit line, the discouraging of global tenders, etc., preference for locally manufactured manufacturers. So what are the benefits and the shortcomings in your view? I know you would like to take a jibe at the Modi government, but can you wear your banker's hat and say, okay, well, this one worked maybe a little bit? Can you do that?
First of all, neither am I interested in talking politics in this forum. It's not like you're going to vote for me or not. You don't have eligibility in my conscience. I know where to talk politics and where to talk policy. So I'm not interested in talking politics here.
No, if there is a criticism, it's fair.
The second point is that I don't have any real depth of understanding of the logic of Atmanirbhar. Because on the one hand, we are clearly a capital constrained country. We are clearly incapable of growing domestically to the level that our ambitions are based on internal demand alone, especially because for the first time since independence, we have seen a slump in demand before the pandemic, which has gotten much worse after the pandemic. So the global problem that existed, let's say, for a long time, but became very evident after the global financial crisis, that no amount of liquidity is leading to actual growth, that the effectively monetary policy has become a useless kind of stimulant, because no matter how much you pump and no matter how many quantitative easings and bond buying programs and curve flattening and twists and all the stuff you do, the money ends up in the hands of people who don't do what you want them to do, which is invest in jobs and growth and real assets and production and trade. It ends up driving up asset prices all over the world. So whatever the problem of monetary policy was that was becoming evident in the world prior to COVID, those problems have become kind of the norm for India as well and become highlighted. I had a meeting with the state level bankers committee last week or earlier this week on Monday or maybe last week, I don't remember. The time is running so fast. But I said, we have a very unusual crisis, because normally in a big economic crisis that leads to a 5, 8, 10% drop in GDP, you will find that there was some kind of over-leveraging or capital decay or market failure or credit crisis or, you know, something, some event, economic event would have, or market event or outcome, or some sustained imbalance being corrected would have been the basis for the crisis. In this crisis, it has been about consciously and purposely shutting both supply and demand for the sake of reducing activity. Like, at least in my lifetime, the first time that it has been the government's job to consciously stall the natural economic activities of human beings. Now, that can have many consequences, but the primary consequences of that in the first instance, at least for a country like ours, is that it greatly exacerbates inequality. You know, in human beings, it separates the well-off that starts with the daily, I mean, with the monthly salaried white-collar workers of deep pocket companies, government employees, relatively wealthy individuals, capitalists, people who live off capital, all of those are better off. And then everybody else is much worse off. And since we're talking about a ratio, probably.
Yeah, you know, I wanted to ask you, I have a lot of questions on the demand side and a lot of things, but since you've brought this topic up, I really want to sort of, I want to get into the economist's head and understand what's happening. It's a larger question. It's not about MSME, it's about economies around the world. Democratic governments around the world, have sort of had this unsaid understanding about what is their role in the economy, right? It was always that of an arbiter between big capital and labor. And here I'm bringing labor and using it in the same breath as MSMEs because, well, they're not much better off in terms of how they feel. This arbitration role between, the big capital wants fewer restrictions, labor wants more protection, and, the government has to find that middle ground. And its benefit is that the economy keeps running and it makes the revenue that it does, which can then be spent on welfare, et cetera, right? That role of an arbiter seems to have been lost across all democratic, countries, because the this capital, this liquidity that you are talking about is becoming financial. The savings are increasing, the rich are saving more, but like you said, they're not investing in plant and machinery and factories. They are just, buying back shares. They are, creating financial structured project products and then making more money out of it. And then which this inequality, which the economists fancily call the K-shaped recovery or whatever, this just seems to be going from bad to worse. And we are now 13 years into the global financial crisis that we saw. This stagnation of investment as a primary source of economic growth, how do we break this cycle?
First of all, I don't think, at least in my view of the world, this kind of balancer between freer enterprise and less regulation and protection of the rights of workers, I think is a very dated model. I don't buy that model at all. I think a smart politician, one who understands policy, who is connected to the people, can sell a completely different model, which is that we either all grow together or, we end up in a situation where we're going to end up creating social strife. So these are the only two outcomes. You have to be on one of two paths. Either you're inclusive and everybody grows together, or some people benefit and other people, the others being 80 or 90 or eventually 95%, get worse off, and then you end up with social strife. So,
this polarization, is really a result of that, because at some level, investors have convinced policymakers, again, not just in India, anywhere else, even in Europe, even in America, that you look the other way while I make the money, right? We'll figure out when the problem comes. I think some sort of an unsaid understanding has been reached everywhere, and that is leading a lot of common people to feel, frustrated and seeking solace in some kind of, whether you call it radical left or radical right, whichever way you want to look at it, whichever end of the spectrum somebody belongs to, that it's exactly what we are seeing, and I'm absolutely on point, in agreement with you on that. And we need to, the inequality, the big businesses and policymakers have to address inequality to make sure that the society comes back to a certain amount of stability as we knew it, you know, a few years ago, I guess. So let's come back to MSME then. I'm sorry for taking this little detour, but I just couldn't help it. It's a question that keeps me, I wouldn't say keeps me awake at night, but keeps me awake a lot of times, trying to make sense of the world. I guess that's my job. So let's talk about MSMEs, and you have announced a package recently, as in Tamil Nadu government has announced a package, and 280 crores capital subsidy, you know, support for emergency loans for working capital. We are coming back to the same thing, cash, capital and credit. And these have always been in short supply, and I've been saying this throughout this event in all our conversations. It's always been in short supply. Again, is there an out-of-the-box idea that the banker, Palaniveel Thyagarajan, can bring to the table and say, well, here's how we address it? Because, well, I'm going to come to the next question. I mean, what the idea that I have, but I would like to hear you out first.
Yeah, I mean, more than anything else, I worry that the translation of intent into outcome is so inefficient. Again, I'll go back to the meeting we had last week with the bankers. In the course of the meeting, it became apparent to me that not everything that the RBI intended or said in their statements was fully understood by all the banks at the meeting. They didn't know what all schemes could be done, what all ways, and they had questions for the RBI. RBI promised to run training sessions and clarification sessions and modification of the announced programs based on feedback from the banks. That should not have needed to wait for the finance minister of the state to convene a meeting. There should be better linkages between the regulator and the banks. The second was that many of the banks said that they were not able to get the MSMEs to come and sign up and take advantage of the programs announced by both the union government and the RBI. So they asked us to facilitate by running training sessions and so forth. At which point I said, why should we do this separately? We should do it together. Why don't the banks and the government together run training sessions of what all programs and what all relief and what all you know, kind of measures have been announced in round two, round three, round four, and all these things. And also that, you know, basically we are, what can I say, mentoring. So, you know, some big industrialists, as you said earlier, a lot of the big industrial groups are the lifeblood of the MSMEs because, you know, in, for example, the auto industry or in other industries, you know, there's the kind of large scale assemblers, brand managers, and then there are the OEMs, and then the second tier OEMs, third tier, and so on and so forth. So they too said that we can help in some ways when I had the conversation with the CII. So I think the overall system now is that you get all the talent together, you get the management talent, you get the capital provider, which is the bank, which is working capital or its debt, and then you get the government, and you all three together kind of help these individuals come out of the problem. Now, you've got two other structural problems. The first problem is bankers are human beings, and for bankers, it's a lot easier to restructure 1,000 crore loan than to restructure 110 crore loans or 1,000 1 crore loans. So they look to reduce their workload and make sure that they don't have to worry about dotting so many I's and crossing so many T's. There's a second problem, which is that banks are inherently the wrong kind of lender for certain types of risks. Banks, as you know, the asset liability management of banks is a highly complicated business, particularly when it comes to duration and particularly when it comes to equity-like risk. Banks should not be in that business at all, you know, high yield and above, or actual mezzanine debt or subordinated debt or outright equity. But there's no real, you know, kind of fully developed capital market to provide those kinds of financing in other places. So all of that comes from the banks. So now banks end up with what we, you know, see as heavy pro-cyclicality, which is that just like the union government's kind of compensation program to the states never envisioned a kind of all correlations go to one crisis, in which case the only time states really need compensation, the union government says, I don't have any compensation to give. The rest of the time, if the economy is doing well, we don't even need the competition, you know, compensation. What does it matter if it's set at 7 or 10 or 14? We're growing at 18. There's never going to be need for you to give me any money. So this pro-cyclicality that precisely when you really have to step up is when you're going to find it difficult. In the case of banks, it goes the other way, that when the probability of default goes up, automatically the loss given default also goes up because there's no buyer for the distressed asset. There's no way to recover without actual liquidation, et cetera, et cetera. So it's a complex problem. It's driven structurally by inefficiencies in the market of credit and of equity. And, you know, we don't have nearly as well developed a capital market as, let's say, an advanced economy. It's much more problematic is the rent-seeking behavior and lack of both competence and integrity of government officials in the process. And because all those effects are felt disproportionately by the poorest, weakest sections, right? Like, you know, the biggest corporates dictate to the government how the government should run. And the government dictates to the micro businessman how his life should be run. So you have an imbalance there also. So I think these are, of course, global problems to some level, but they are very, very uniquely Indian at some other level. You know, I give you the simple example. I lived 20 years in the States. And when I came back, people said, what's the biggest difference between America and India? I said, in America, every question has a different answer, irrespective of the person asking it. How do I get a license? Follow this procedure. How do I register my company? Follow this procedure. How do I pay tax for this kind of corporation? Follow this procedure. So the answers differ based on the question, and they are the same no matter who asks the question. In India, it's exactly the reverse. The answer is the same to all questions for one person. How do you get a license? Who wants to know? How do I register this? Who wants to know? If you are at this level of society, it's a different answer. If you're at this level of society, it's a different answer. If you're, you know, Ambani, Adani Enterprises, is a different answer. If you're TVS, et cetera, is a different answer. If you're, you know, medium scale, is a different answer. If you're a micro, it's a different answer. So this problem is acute under normal circumstances and hugely problematic in a crisis because nobody quite knows what they're doing. Leave the malintent and all that out. It was very clear to me in the meeting that neither the RBI to the banks, nor the banks to the clients, nor the banks to the government, nor the clients to the government, none of these linkages were at the level they should have been. And we're not talking like the crisis started yesterday. This crisis is 1.5 or 1.25 years old. It is still not well integrated.
So, you know, like you said, you know, show me the man, I'll show you the rule. It's an old adage in India. And it's been going on for decades and you know, I don't think it will ever change. That's how we function. That's a little quirk that we carry. I hope it doesn't continue.
I hope it changes.
Yeah. The question really is at the state government level, right? I mean, there are a lot of things that the central government ought to do, the central bank ought to do. You know, of course, we should continue holding them accountable for their statements and or the lack of it. At the state government level, and I think this is an important question that we should ask, is what can you do? And I ask this with the same, you know, for an industrial state like Tamil Nadu. Our history shows that MSMEs thrive when there is a central industry and then there is, you know, ancillary activity around it. You have an auto hub in, you know, Sriperumbudur. You have an auto component hub in Tiruvallur, not very far away. You have similar, like we have seen that in Gurgaon, Haryana as well, Manesar and all those kind of things. So now that, again, I think it somewhat ties up into our previous conversation a couple of questions ago. How do we make that happen? And is that an approach that you would like to take? Make sure that there are fresh investments because you can give a borrower credit, right? The banks can, let us assume that the banks are giving the credit, happy to give. Like they say, people are not signing up. Why will people sign up? Because like you said, there is no demand. I can't export abroad. People don't have purchasing power here. Most of people who can buy things are they're probably buying it at a different level, at a differently priced goods, etc., etc. What is the, where do we take these two threads and tie them into a knot which works?
Yeah, I think it is, maybe I'm right, maybe I'm wrong. I think the kind of lack of demand that the MSMEs see is a completely different issue. In fact, I don't think most MSMEs see that much lack of demand relative to the big corporates, to the big kind of multinationals and the big Indian corporates. I actually think that the very nature of MSMEs is that they serve local markets and kind of more essential needs. And therefore, you know, crisis or no crisis, For the MSMEs, it's much more a supply and a capital and a liquidity management and a keeping afloat when you have to shut down for 2 months problem. Most MSMEs, I think if they could produce, they would actually be able to sell. There is enough demand and enough buyers for them, is my view. It is the large conglomerates and the large capitalists that have the reverse problem. They have unlimited access to capital almost on a relative basis, but their factories are running at 60%, 40%, 50% utilization. How much ever money you give them in increment or how much ever debt you write off, they are not going to invest anymore because they simply, why would anybody build a second factory and the first factory at 60% utilization? So I think we have a situation where this bifurcation of the haves and have-nots has become really problematic. As I said in the SLBC, I said, which crisis has given you record bank deposits and record market valuations? It should be going the other way. But here we have a crisis where we have high, very, very high or absolute record stock market valuations. Bond market yields are down. I mean, now they're starting to pick up with the risk of inflation. That's a different story. But right now, you cannot see another kind of crisis where these two phenomena, huge rise in financial asset values and big noticeable increase in bank deposits. So clearly, this earlier problem that we talked about, which is the, you know, is this the death of monetary policy? Has the world become so unequal that monetary policy simply doesn't work anymore? You know, it really is up to the fiscal approach of the government to reset this imbalance and to make it kind of, and there's a very classic ways to do that, right? I mean, in theory, you could print money, devalue the debt, and make sure that you make the poor get disproportionately, right? So, you know, it's not rocket science and it's not very, you know, far off the norm view. It's just counter to the situation that we have now. That's all.
But there will be implications to devaluing debt at the bank level.
There will be implications for anything. I'm not saying there are easy solutions. I'm just trying to say that we are in a situation where, I ended up saying to the bankers, I recommended three things. I said, number one, improve your infrastructure, improve your processing capacity, improve your restructuring capacity. Don't do 1,000 crore loan, do 1,000 crore loans. Don't do 110 crore loan, do 101 crore loans, et cetera, et cetera. So I think there's certainly that expertise level and that credit diligence level and the kind of connectedness between the lender and the borrower that should facilitate much better lending decisions and outcomes than we have today. But I think there's also the issue of, if the really big corporates and the, you know, the assemblers and the tier one OEMs and so forth are not doing well continuously, then certainly some segment of the MSME sector, probably the M part, the second M part, which is the medium enterprises, are the ones who are going to feel the brunt of that. Because the micros and smalls are very much C2B businesses, right? Consumer to businesses. And therefore, they are not going to be, and they're therefore more essential goods and services and quality of life things. And they're not going to be as affected in a situation like this.
Yeah, at the medium level, there is a lot of capital at stake. There is a lot of debt at stake. And it's really, for families, this entire MSME exchange, our conversations, our artwork, everything, the posters that you see, we've put people first because when we talk about MSME, I think we are, especially we as journalists, are tuned to thinking about a small shop or a small manufacturing unit. What we don't realize is that behind the small manufacturing unit is a family that is dependent on that aspiration, their education, their well-being. And one such dream broken has a cascading effect on the entire community. And I think that we need to be, we have to deal with it with a certain amount of sensitivity that it deserves, I guess. But on one last bit, Minister, before I let you go, we've spoken at length about the dearth of cash, capital and credit. We also have now a dearth of technology because like we said, you know, technology, we are going through a generational shift in technology, which is largely beyond the grasp, both in terms of comprehension, familiarity, as well as affordability for a lot of these people, right? I mean, how are you going to convince a 50-year-old man who's been doing business a certain way, works on relationships, etc., to say that, well, here is a cloud solution. Well, here is a blockchain solution. And I think before this pandemic is over, most of them are going to wake up, and I hope we come to life as normal. But when it does come, they're going to wake up and say, well, we've already lost the race because a lot of others have gone way beyond us, and I don't think we can catch up anymore. How do we, as at the policy level, how do we address it?
Yeah, I mean, I think obviously everybody's situation is different. Let me just say from a Tamil Nadu perspective that all the data we have, both in terms of internet penetration, point of sale machine penetration, kind of inventory systems connected to the point of sale machine, etc. I would say that we are much better than I thought we would be. I thought that we would be very, very low or minor adaptation, and that the bulk of it would be kind of fought. But I am pleasantly surprised that because of, I guess, the 50, 100 years of focus on education for all and social justice and equality and access and all that, Tamil Nadu has the highest penetration rates of internet in the rural areas. It has the lowest percentage of rural population. For that rural lowest percentage population, it has the highest, penetration. So it is not unreasonable to find point of sale terminals in like petty shops in villages even. So I think, of course, you need to run. Actually, I'll go one step further. Many of these things are not best done by government. They are best done by suppliers, by, you know, kind of, you know, if you look at most of the shops that how they came online, the petty shop, just to give you an example, it is because ITC or Unilever or one of these companies showed that it was mutually beneficial to have an integrated inventory management system that also tied up the shop's POS, and therefore it was win-win-win. The shopkeeper got to run their business better. They got to not have to worry about when to order what supplies and whatnot. The inventory chain got better managed. And then the big corporate or their big corporate's dealer got to have line of sight into not just supply chain timing and prediction, but also into consumer behavior and the adaptation of their brands and stuff like that. So, you know, especially when I had the CII event and also my personal friends like the TVS group, they are very keen that they can facilitate a lot of this stuff, right? It's because everybody's selling or buying to somebody, and there are very few businesses that are truly 100% retail small scale businesses. And even if they are, they are part of some network. They are part of an association of plumbers, or they're part of the footwear dealers, merchants group or something. Or they are by caste, as I said earlier. You know, all the Marwari businessmen of Madurai have their own little community. So you go through them to do the facilitation. I think it's very hard for the government by itself to be the one that does this, partly because the government itself doesn't have huge amounts of expertise in the communication and is not always up to speed. It's not like we're consistently updating ourselves on what the RBI has said or what the banks are doing or whatever. So, and this, let me just end with this example then. If you look at Africa, the decades, the 6 to 8 decades of enormous amounts of aid pouring in could not do in terms of either infrastructure growth or economic growth or even rising kind of incomes and therefore declining poverty, what 10 to 15 years of massive Chinese investment during the height of the commodity cycle did. The Chinese came in a big way. They needed a lot of raw materials. They came in a big way. They built the roads and the schools and the hospitals and the ports and the airports. And that led to much, much greater economic growth rates than 20 years of relatively altruistic, or not 20, 50 years of relatively altruistic outright aid, right? So sometimes, you know, the you have to find the right approach to facilitate the outcome.
I think, you know, we're running out of time here, but, you know, I know it is very usual for folks in the media to talk about Tamil Nadu and bring in, you know, the film industry to talk about it before the elections every time. And I want to sort of break that cycle and talk about it after the election, because the film industry in Tamil Nadu is big, is a big employer, but it is also a collection of thousands of really self-employed people. They're not, you know, they don't draw monthly salaries, not all the time. Every single movie has to be, you know, like they say in Tamil, office potacha. You know, it's an MSME by itself, every production, you know. So what is the outlook there? I mean, they have, again, this pandemic has broken their back. How much of revenue does Tamil Nadu government make from this industry, and what is it now planning to give it back to the artists and the support staff, the cameramen, the technicians, and those kind of people who are really sort of, you know, on the verge of bankruptcy, and many of them are bankrupt?
Yeah, I don't know. I don't have the data to indicate what does and doesn't come to the government. I'll just say two, three things about the movie industry in general, and to the best of my knowledge, almost all of that applies to Tamil Nadu cinema. You know, if you go to any of the top business schools in the US or in Europe, sooner or later you will come across a case study on the financing of movies. Right? Movies are not purely art anymore. Movies are actually models of financing. And you can start seeing, you know, how much of the income is expected to come from the box office, which is almost irrelevant in the first version, how much from sequels, how much from merchandising, how much from rights to broadcast, to TV, to straight to home, to whatever it is. And really, you can win or lose in the movie business just by being a really good banker. And, you know, at least when I was in the US, there was one banker, who was JP Morgan, I think, who dominated the industry. He was the man who understood how all these things work. And of course, you know, human relationships play a part in that. Why I say that is, it's almost worse than rolling the dice at craps making movies, right? That was true in the US, and to the best of my knowledge, it's true in Tamil Nadu, is that I would be shocked if more than 10% of the movies broke even for the producers when all is said and done, right? So, you know, of course, employment is a different thing, you know, payrolls are a different thing, but on an outright profit margin basis, it would be shocking if more than 10% of the movies made profit. So what that does, at least in Hollywood, it's fully done. And in India, it was starting to get done. And there's one new nice innovation that changes that. What that does is it separates the market into really only two levels. The mega movie, those who can afford the 100 million, 500 million in financing with the option and the put and the calls and the, you know, syndicates and all of this stuff. And maybe that works out well and gives you 8% or 10% return is the less than spectacular case. One out of 100 will become such a big hit that it'll spawn billions and sequels and all that. And then, you know, about 50% of them will have been a waste of money. But if you have diversified the sources of financing, you'll still get to live, right? Then you go, there is no 80 million movie, there's no 60 million movie, there's no 50 million movie, there's no 20 million movie. Then you go to the indie films of the 2 to 5 to 10 million, right? So the industry bifurcates into mega and
it's a K-shaped model. Recovery, K-shaped model there as
well. Yeah, is and that's how the industry used to be. And I could see that was happening to the Tamil Nadu market as well. What has changed the market first in Hollywood and then in Tamil Nadu and in, I think Tamil Nadu particular, I'm sure it is in Bollywood also, but I'm not aware, I'm not as connected, is the advent of the Amazons and the Netflixes and all of these guys in the world. And those guys have the built-in audience and they don't need to make money out of any particular movie because they're making subscriptions. So one good movie can ensure that the revenue model for the next 6 months runs, because people remember, oh, I saw that on Netflix, or they can take it on and off and so forth. So that has actually disrupted the market now and brought it back to the possibility that you can make 5 million, 10 million, 20 million, 40 million movies, or series or whatever it is, even in a place like the US. And also in Tamil Nadu, I can start to see that yep. there are made directly for Amazon Prime or made directly for Netflix movies and series and so forth. So I hope that is the revival of the industry. The revival of the industry is not going to come because the government supports it or doesn't, or because we reduce one tax or we give some rebate. The revival of the industry is going to come when you have an efficient market. And the efficient market will come when you can have...
There are many buyers, as many suppliers. Yeah,
and also you'll have, because you'll have many buyers and many price points, you can have people who can make, you know, who can aim for mini, micro, medium, large, extra large and humongous, right? And you don't have to separate into these two things. That would be my take.
Awesome. And is there any, I hope I have covered as much as I wanted to, as much I should. Did I miss anything? Would you like to highlight something that's close to your heart
In this particular space, not just...
No, it's not my direct field. As at a policy level and someone with input into the governor's address and eventually to write the budget and present it, the chief minister is very focused on the MSME sector. We understand there are three separate components here. One is the state's role to manage its finances and its kind of debt properly, so it's not crowding out others in the market and basically keeping things going at a reasonable level, mostly because it can then invest in the kind of infrastructure that allows for greenfield investments, what you talked about. That is, that we put up roads and bridges and ports and power systems and drinking water systems and hospitals and things like that. There's what the old government used to call the Global Investor Meet, which was the most inane thing I've heard, because as anybody who studied even the basics of macroeconomic knows, companies and corporations are consumers of capital. They're not investors of capital, right? It's the asset managers, it's the pension funds, the insurance companies, the rich individuals, the mutual funds that are the investors. So the global corporates who are consumers of global capital is where the previous government had put a lot of its efforts and to not, as you saw, most of those went off to Andhra or Telangana or some other place. We want to bring them back, but the way we bring them back is because of our natural strengths of the English speaking workforce, the scale, the business friendly environment, the infrastructure, and a strong MSME, second tier, third tier OEM supplier base. And so I think we have three areas of focus. One, to do our job and infrastructure funding and financing properly, that is from the markets, from us, and from truly large global investors like private equity funds, big asset managers, so forth. Two, to build the MSME sector, to do facilitation in every district for them, to give them the kind of attention, the training, the mentoring, the access to bank resources that otherwise used to be given to the global corporates who don't need it. They know what job they're doing. They don't need you to tell them anything. And if we do these two parts right, then the global corporates will come by themselves. We will get back to being what we used to be, which is the number one investment destination, the investment destination of choice in India because of all the other strengths that we bring to bear. And I think that is the...
So are you saying that you are talking to the pension fund and the...
mutual funds and private equity and not to the corporate, like you want the capital and who will it be routed via?
Unless we build infrastructure, unless we fix our finances, unless we provide the kind of environment to make it attractive, there's no point talking to anybody. What does talking to them do? They want to find the place where their risk of loss is low and their likelihood of success is high. I got to create that environment. After I create that environment, of course, I'll go and woo them. Why would I not? I'm not like the previous government where the minister, one of my colleagues, TRB Raja, asked in the assembly, how is it that all these other companies, states are taking tours around the world trying to solicit business from Silicon Valley, from New York, from Frankfurt, from Singapore, from this, that. Why are you not doing anything like this? And the industries minister in the previous government said, you know, Amma's government is so great. Amma is so great that the line outside my door is so long that I cannot even meet everybody who wants to talk to me. Why would I go and solicit anybody? I mean, what logic is that, right? I mean, the statistics show the decline. The statistics show that in Tamil Nadu used to be 11% of India's manufacturing in 2011, and it dropped to 9% by 2016. It's probably dropped further still now. In the same period, Gujarat used to be 11% of India's manufacturing in 11, went up to 13% in 2016. Andhra used to be 6% of India's manufacturing in 2011, separated Andhra, became 8% in 2016. Phenomenal, phenomenal market share growth. So, you know, it was a lack of vision, lack of leadership that led to that problem.
On that note, I have a specific industry example, and you can correct me if I'm wrong. I am talking based on anecdotes. There has been a logistics revolution in Tamil Nadu of some sort at a small level. And there is a success story there where it has helped a lot of MSMEs as well. A lot of business in the logistics space, including foreign investors, have managed to enter Tamil Nadu in the last decade or so and are now increasing investments. Would you like to talk to us about that,
what worked there?
Last decade seems a bit off to me. I would say there was a golden period. There was a period, and independent of politics, I'm saying, there was a period between deregulation in 91 and let's say 2014-15. When Ms. Jayalalitha was still in control. So whether it was the ADMK government, DMK government, there was progressive views. You know, many of the projects that are landmark now, like the tidal park, like the IT corridor, like the OMR, like the Saint-Gobain glass, like the Ford kind of offshoring and then manufacturing. All of these were driven by Kalaivar Kalaignar when he was chief minister in the two terms, right? I'm not saying she was not that good. I'm saying she did other projects. There are many projects that she can cite as well. It is between 2014 when she went to jail for the first time in Bangalore from the trial court, and then her attention on the thing dropped. It is between 2014 and 2021 really that we have suffered a lot. So I don't really have a lot to say as a positive story. Statistically, the RBI has pointed out that our share in the economy has dropped. Not just what I told you about our share of India's manufacturing. Tamil Nadu's economy used to be over 23-24% mines and industries, mines and manufacturing, industrial sector back in 2011. By 2016, that had dropped to 17-18%. So the nature of our economy had shifted quite a bit away from the higher value add, formal job creating, you know, second order, third order SME benefiting work towards construction and services and, you know, these kinds of things.
Minister, I would have loved to go a little deeper on the question of data that you spoke about, because there are a lot of questions being raised about the quality of data that has been coming out of India in the recent past. But I think I've already taken a lot of your time. Thank you so much for being patient and answering all my questions. That's all the time we have with the Finance Minister of Tamil Nadu. On to our next session, a very special one. We've spoken to a politician.